morning. Let's all stand.
As we are here this morning, the first thing we want to do is just thank you, Lord, again for your mercy and for your grace, for your kindness, for your forgiveness, Lord. Lord, we thank you that you by yourself have purged our sins and tell us that our sins and our iniquities you'll remember no more. We thank you for this new covenant that you've given us, Lord, in Christ Jesus. And so, Lord, this morning, as we just set aside this time to open our hearts and to worship you, Lord, and to study your word, Father, speak to us, we pray this morning, in the mighty name of Jesus. And all God's kids would say, amen. 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 Let's remain standing.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger. The King of glory, the King above all kings, shakes the whole earth. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in all it wonder. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You lay down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who rules the nations with truth and justice? Shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You lay down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Sing, worthy. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You lay down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
You can be seated.
Strength arises, we wait upon the Lord. We'll wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength arises, we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Our God, you reign forever. Our hope, our strong deliverer. You are the everlasting God, the everlasting God. You do not faint, you won't grow weary. You're the defender of the weak. You comfort those in need. You lift us up on wings like eagles. Strength arises, we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength arises, we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord our God. You reign forever. Our hope, our strong deliverer. You are the everlasting God. The everlasting God. You do not faint, you won't grow weary. You're the defender of the weak. You comfort those in need. You lift us up on wings like eagles. Strength arises, we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Our Father everlasting, the all-creating one, God Almighty. And through your Holy Spirit, conceiving Christ the Son, Jesus our Savior. I believe in God our Father, I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. Our judge and our defender suffered and crucified. Forgiveness is in you. Descended into darkness, you rose in glorious life, forever seated high. I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus.
I believe in life eternal.
I believe in life eternal. I believe in the virgin birth. I believe in the saints' communion and in your holy church. I believe in the resurrection when Jesus comes again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. For I believe in the name of Jesus.
I'll stand. I close my eyes to see my King in majesty. Your grace compels my soul to love and draw them close. And I lift my hands and sing, surrender everything. In you I know I'm found. My God, to you I'll bow. Now and till forever, Jesus, I surrender. Show me what I don't know, more of you. I'm desperate for your presence, longing to be with you. Lead me to a new place, more of you. Through the fire I'll persevere. I won't submit to any fear. And where I go, you've been before. All my trust is in you, Lord. Now and till forever, Jesus, I surrender. Show me what I don't know, more of you. I'm desperate for your presence, longing to be with you. Lead me to a new place, more of you. Now and till forever, Jesus, I surrender. Show me what I don't know, more of you. I'm desperate for your presence, longing to be with you. Lead me to a new place, more of you. I need is you. All I need is you, Lord. Is you, Lord. All I need is you. All I need is you, Lord. Is you, Lord. All I need is you. All I need is you, Lord, is you. All I need is you. Sing that one more time.
All I need is you, Lord, is you, Lord. All I need is you.
Lord, why are we so slow to know that? You know, we search for satisfaction in all the wrong places. We fill our life and clutter it with things that can never satisfy, because they're temporal and they're temporary. Father, you created us to know you. You created us for fellowship with you. You created us to be filled with your Spirit. And man sinned and sinned that away. And so he chases around in the darkness, groping and looking for things that can never satisfy. And yet your Holy Spirit calls us into that place of intimacy, that place where we can only be fulfilled and satisfied, that place of being born again filled with your Spirit, so that life has purpose, it has meaning, it has direction, it has hope. And so, Lord, we thank you this morning that we have found that hope in you. We thank you this morning that every moment of every day we sense your presence. We thank you, Father, this morning for your grace, Lord, that is so beyond anything that we could ever have hoped for, that you would save us apart from any efforts of our own, just because you're merciful. We thank you for that this morning. And Lord, if there be any in here, Lord, this morning, that's hearts have grown cold, just take them back to the cross. Take them back to that moment where they first met you. And Lord, in that sense of their sins being forgiven and that weight being lifted and that hope, Lord, just driving away the darkness and that peace that passed all understanding. You know, I love that old song that Andre Crouch sang, "Take Me Back." Take me back to the place where I first met you, Lord. And I think sometimes we need to pray that prayer. I pray it this morning for this congregation. Take us back, Lord. May our walk with you be intimate and personal. We thank you this morning for your grace. We're such a mess. But Lord, we thank you we're your mess. And so we just lift the needs of this congregation before you this morning. We specifically want to pray for Scott Ruiz and Donna's that are in the hospital. And Lord, we just pray that everything would go well for the hernia surgery. Just bless him, Lord, such a servant, he and his wife. Want to lift Susan Stubblefield before you again. The shingles are back. And God, we just pray that you would comfort her and take away any of the pain. Be with her, Lord, this morning. Want to pray for the ladies that are over in, I don't know how you even pray for that, in Bodega Bay. Just enjoying the fellowship. And this morning we pray for their service there. We pray for Tracy as she leads worship. Lord, we pray for whoever's bringing the message this morning. And Lord, we just thank you that many of the ladies get to get away once a year and just go to Bodega Bay and spend time with one another, just bonding and resting and just encouraging one another. Lord, just may your Spirit be there upon them. Give them a safe journey home when they come home on Tuesday, Lord. Bless them, Lord, is our prayer. And bless those husbands who stayed home, who are about to pull every hair out of their head, that have one nerve left dealing with the kids, that aren't even here this morning. They're probably watching live stream while they're trying to choke or strangle some of their children, Lord. So bless them as well, Lord, we pray. May your grace be sufficient, Lord, we ask. And we just lift these things to you this morning in the mighty name of Jesus, and all God's kids would say, amen, amen, amen. Well, hey, take a few moments and greet one another before you settle into your spot. Good morning. All right, if you guys could settle into your spots, we'll get moving. Okay. That probably brings back some childhood memories, doesn't it? The bell being rung, recess is over. Time to get back into the classroom. See what the Lord has for us this morning. Again, continue to pray. Some of us are going to go by and anoint Scott with oil. And just continue to pray for he and for Susan Stubblefield. This is pretty serious, the things that they're experiencing. Amen. Hey, let's turn our Bibles this morning. We've come as far as Matthew chapter 26. And verse 14 is where we're going to pick up. That's where we left off last week. And so as you're turning to Matthew chapter 26, put your finger there on verse 14 and let's pray. Father, we're coming to a very interesting section now as the ministry of Jesus, as far as the teaching and healing ministry, is now coming to an end. The cross is before him. We're going to pick up at the Last Supper and then move into the Garden of Gethsemane, and then ultimately the betrayal and crucifixion. And Lord, I must confess, when I get to this area, it saddens me. There's an old hymn that says that I hear my own voice among those who cry for your crucifixion. And to know that as we get to that part, to that portion, to those verses, to that section, Lord, that we crucified him. It was our sins that nailed him to the cross. And it saddens me, Lord, but in the midst of that sadness, there's great joy and there's great understanding and hope in the fact that we know that it was necessary that Jesus die, because we can never be good enough. The standard is perfection, and we couldn't be perfect, and yet the perfect one came, the Lamb without spot, without blemish, and suffered and died in our stead, that we might be forever forgiven and cleansed. And so, Lord, we thank you as we're coming into that section this morning. And, Lord, I pray that as we're moving toward that, I'm asking this morning, Lord, that you would give us a whole new experience in that, Lord, that, you know, because we've heard it so many times, it wouldn't grow cold or old. It wouldn't be stale, but it would be as though we heard it for the first time again. The love of God and the sending of his Son to suffer and die for our sins. It would be as though we have all new ears and our hearts are just freshly in tune with what is being said. So, Lord, speak to us this morning, we would pray. In the mighty name of Jesus, we would ask. And all God's kids would say, amen. Amen. You know, again, we're entering into that section of the scripture where the triumphant entry is in the past now. A few days ago, Jesus came in triumphantly. In fact, it's interesting to me, had they been studying the book of Daniel, they would have known the very day. They could have begun to do the count of 173,880 days from the decree that Artaxerxes gave in 445 B.C., and they would have known the very day that he was going to come in triumphantly. The triumphant entry is behind him. The meal there in Bethany is now behind them, where Simon, the ex-leper who was healed, it was his house. He was the father, as we saw last week, of Mary, Martha, and Lazarus. Jesus dined with Simon, who was a leper, no longer a leper. Leprosy being a type of sin, being cleansed. There in the house was Lazarus, who once was dead and now is alive. Can you imagine that meal? And no doubt blind Bartimaeus was there as well, because he was part of that procession we read about in the triumphant entry, going into Bethany and now having a meal with Jesus. So you have a leper who was cleansed. That's us. You have a dead person made alive. That's us. You have a blind person now who can see. That's us. And that meal is behind, and Jesus went into the temple, and he's taught all day Tuesday, rebuking the religious system and the religious leaders of the day that didn't understand that it's a relationship that God is after, not a religion. He pronounces 8 woes upon them. 7 times he calls them hypocrites. 5 times he says they're blind. And 3 times he calls them morons as he lays out the kingdom of heaven. His final act, his final sermon, that's behind him now. As he left, he went to the Mount of Olives, and there, even in a more intimate way, discussed with his disciples what the last days would look like, the signs that would just precede his coming in the end of the world. And he laid those things out. Now he's moving toward the Last Supper, the Passover meal, and after that, the crucifixion. We pick up there in verse 14, a very interesting thing, and there's a lot of application for us as we work our way through these next passages. We're just going to go through about verse, we'll go as far as we can. I have a stopping spot. If I don't get any further than that, I'll be okay. But verse 14 says this, "Then one of his 12, called Judas Iscariot, went unto the chief priests, and he said unto them, What will you give me? And I will deliver him unto you." Isn't that interesting? Something stirring in the heart of Judas Iscariot. We don't know. And listen, I read to a nauseam different commentaries trying to say what the motive was for Judas Iscariot, who, listen, had traveled with Jesus for 3 years, had seen the miracles, had heard the teaching, was no doubt in the boat when Jesus came walking on water, was in that same boat when Jesus calmed the sea and the winds and the rain and the clear sky came, was there when the leper was healed, Simon, was there when Lazarus was raised from the dead, was there when blind Bartimaeus got his sight, was there when Jesus cast out the demons there in the area of the Gadarenes. He was there, no doubt, when Jesus turned water into wine. No doubt he was there. Well, for all of the miracles and for all of the teaching. And yet for all of that, he still does not see. He is as blind as Bartimaeus was before he was healed. He is still filled with sin, just like Simon before he was cleansed. He is as dead as Lazarus was before he was raised from the dead, because now he seeks to betray the Lord. And again, I've read to a nauseam different motives, and some sign great noble motives to him. Well, he was trying to push Jesus into coming as the Messiah and destroying the Roman government. And listen, I read in my Bible only one motive, and I'm not going to assume any other motive. It's the motive of greed, of self, of selfishness, desiring the things of the world more than the things of God. Because we read there, he says unto these, and by the way, this is fulfillment of prophecy. We'll look at that in a few moments. "What will you give me? And I will deliver him unto you." And they covenanted with him for 30 pieces of silver. Zechariah tells us, and this is a fulfillment of prophecy in Zechariah chapter 11. In fact, there's a lot of fulfillment of prophecy as we work our way through the final moments of Jesus' life. In Zechariah chapter 11, verses 12 and 13, it says this, "And I said unto them, If you think good, give me my price, and if not, forbear. So they weighed out for my price 30 pieces of silver. And the Lord said unto me, Cast it unto the potter's field, a goodly price which I was prized at them of. And I took the 30 pieces of silver, and I cast it to them in the potter's field in the house of the Lord." One of the last minor prophets of the Old Testament, Zechariah, is describing in one of the greatest details what we'll read about in chapter 27. When Judas had already betrayed Jesus, when they had came and arrested him, something began to cook in his heart. He understood that he had betrayed innocent blood. He went back to the temple to try to give the 30 pieces of silver back. They said, "The deal is done. What you have done cannot be undone." And so in shame and in agony and in guilt, he threw the 30 pieces of silver into the temple and went out and hanged himself. They took those 30 pieces of silver and bought a potter's field. We'll see that in a couple chapters. Chapter 27, fulfillment of Scripture. It's also interesting that in Exodus chapter 21, verse 32, that we find out there that the price of an ox that gores a servant and so that the servant dies is 30 pieces of silver. A pierced servant. One who has been killed. The price is 30 pieces of silver. Now, that's not a lot of money. Historians tell us, and they had a hard time settling on an amount, but it's somewhere between $25 and $50. So this man, Judas Iscariot, was willing to betray the Lord of glory for $25 to $50. You know, I find it incredibly interesting what I'm able and willing to betray him for. Spurgeon said some would betray him for a smile because they're men pleasers and they want to be accepted by people. He also says some would betray Jesus for a snare. They don't want to be rejected. They want people to like them. Some would betray him for a house or for a car, for a 401 bank account. Some would betray him for some of the simplest things that are only temporary. That's why the Bible said, what does it profit a man if he gains the whole world and loses his own soul? Listen, the most precious thing, hear me this morning, saints. Listen, guys and gals. Listen, sons and daughters of the living God. The most precious thing you have was a gift given to you by the Father of lights in whom there is no shadow of turning. And that gift that he gave you, he will not take it back because the gifts and callings of God are irrevocable. God will not take those things back. The most precious thing you've been given is eternal life, this gift of grace and salvation and forgiveness. Listen, you need to deem that to be the most precious thing that you own. And you need to guard your hearts against anyone ever stealing that away from you. Make your calling an election that is sure. Put your body, as Romans chapter 12 says, on the altar of God as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto the Lord. It's your reasonable service, seeing all that the Lord has done for us. And be not conformed to this world. Why? Because this world is perishing. That's why we're told to love not the world nor the things that are in the world, because if the love of the world be in you, the love of the Father cannot. They can't coexist. Jesus said, listen, you can't serve two masters. You're going to love one and hate the other. You need to make a decision. Why? Because all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life, they're of the world, and this world is passing away. Look around. It's not hard to see. Ray Charles, in his current condition, can see that this world is passing away. But he that doth the will of the Father shall abide forever. I think the lesson before us and the application in this lesson is, what would you be willing to betray Jesus for? I hope nothing. But he was willing to do it for the smallest of prices, 30 pieces of silver. And verse 16 says, and from that time he sought opportunity to betray him. We move from that scene now to the Last Supper, because it says there in verse 17, now the first day of the Feast of Unleavened Bread, the disciples came to Jesus, saying unto him, where will we prepare for thee to eat the Passover? Very special meal. Every Jewish person was required to observe this particular festival. In fact, it spoke volumes to them. They were in Egypt and in bondage, and when God began to judge Egypt, which is a type of the world, and the very last plague, he told them, you take a lamb, you watch that lamb, very interesting, for 5 days to make sure it's without spot. How long was Jesus in Jerusalem? 5 days. And you examine that lamb, and then at the end of the 5 days, you take that lamb to the doorpost of your house, right there in the entryway. You slit its throat, you bleed the blood out, and you apply the blood to the doorpost and to the lintel, forming two crosses. One Jesus bore, the other one you bear. And God said, when I see the blood, judgment will pass from you. I will pass over your house, and no judgment will come. Today the blood is applied to you and I. And when it's applied to the person who's born again, judgment does not come to that house, doesn't come to that home. Verse 18 says, and he said, go into a certain city to such a man. He's given him a particular place and a particular person to go see, and say unto him, the master saith, my time is at hand. I will keep the Passover at thy house with thy disciples. Wouldn't you have liked to have been that guy? Wouldn't you like to hear a knock on a door and there's some of the disciples saying, hey, listen, the master has need of your house. He wants to have the last meal that he's going to have here on earth with his disciples. He wants to have it in your home. And so they went, and it says the disciples did as Jesus appointed them, and they made ready the Passover. Now when the eve was come, he sat down with his 12. And as they ate, listen what he says. He said unto them, verily I say unto you, that one of you shall betray me. One of you are going to betray me. Isn't it interesting? This is the fulfillment of Psalms 41:9. In Psalms 41:9, it says this, yea, my own familiar friend. Hey, listen, have you ever been betrayed by a friend, a close person, family member, someone you care deeply for? Someone you invited into your life and into your inner circles that you shared your heart with, that you shared your emotions with, that you've wept with, that you've rejoiced with. How many have been betrayed by a close friend? Raise your hand. How many have been betrayed by a close friend? Isn't that a pain like no other pain? Doesn't your mind just swirl around the fact, how could they do that? You invited him into your life. You invited him in to that inner circle of your emotion. You opened your heart to them. And now you're being betrayed. Can you imagine what Jesus is feeling, what he is sensing now? He invited Judas in. He was one of the 12. He traveled with them. He ate with them. They slept around the same campfire. In Psalms 41, verse 9, which again is a fulfillment of what we see here in Matthew chapter 26, said, yea, my own familiar friend, in whom I trusted, which did eat of my bread. In a few moments, he's going to say, the one who dipped his bread in the bowl of the sop or soup and ate with me, he's the one who betrayed me, hath lifted up his heel against me. You know, when you go through those times and in those moments where you feel betrayed, listen, the Bible says we have a faithful high priest who's been tempted and has suffered in every aspect that you and I have been tempted and have suffered in, only he without sin. So when you bring your broken heart to him, you know, some of you sitting here have gone through divorce. And you felt that betrayal where a wife or a husband has been unfaithful and just left. Some of you have had your father or mother completely abandon you. Some of you brothers and sisters. Some of you by the church have been forced out and pushed out. And listen, those that you once thought the best of and once you had the greatest relationship with have betrayed you. Jesus understands all of this. He's going to be betrayed. He's going to hear in a few hours the words, give us Barabbas, a murderer. Crucify Jesus. He's going to be hanging on a cross, and he's going to hear words from the crowd saying, take down that he was the king of the Jews. He's not our king. We will not have this man reign over us. He's going to be stripped in shame, beaten beyond recognition, put a crown of thorns upon his head and mocked, carry a 200-pound cross to Golgotha, all the while being spat upon and cursed at, the one, the only one who came to save sinners. I think one of the greatest pains that he's going to experience is his betrayal, but not greater pain than when the Father, because Habakkuk says his eyes are too pure to look upon sin, has to turn away and for 6 hours hang on a cross for the first time in eternity. God the Father will be separated from God the Son. While the sin of the world without it mixture comes upon him, this is what he is facing. And so as he's sitting there, the last meal, he says, verily I say unto you, one of you shall betray me. And they were exceedingly sorrowful, verse 22 says, and they began every one of them to say unto him, Lord, is it I? I like that they don't accuse somebody else. Now, Peter, in a few moments, will kind of get into that mode. He's going to say, man, I knew you couldn't trust these guys. Oh, man, I've been watching them for 3 years, and I didn't trust them. I knew one of these guys was going to mess up. But me, Jesus, I'm with you till the death. We're going to get to that section today, and we're going to look and learn some things from it. But Jesus has said during this very intimate moment when they're having the pre-meal before they go through the Passover meal and they're there fellowshipping and eating and breaking bread, Jesus said, one of you is going to betray me. And everyone begins to do self-examination. Here's what it says in 2 Corinthians chapter 13. Turn there for a moment, and I think every one of us ought to have this practice in our lives. Our focus when we come to church shouldn't be on the person sitting next to you or in front of you or behind you. So many times do we not listen to the messages or as we're teaching through the Word, and we think, how that might apply to that person. Oh, how that is fitting for that other guy. Oh, man, I wish brother so-and-so or sister so-and-so were here. They needed to hear this. Instead of saying to yourself, is this one for me? You know, we understand in counseling it's called deflection. When you don't want to deal with the issues of your own life, you deflect and you make it about somebody else instead of about you. I think we ought to come to church, and when we do and we find our place and we sit down and the message is being delivered, we ought to act like there's nobody else in the building. I know I do. Hey, if all of you guys didn't show up some Sunday, I'd just put a mirror right there in the front and I'd preach at me because I need to be preached at. I need to be convicted by the Holy Spirit. Man, I need to have a new taste of grace and forgiveness every day. I don't want to pop your bubble, but your pastor's not perfect. But he is forgiven. And he is washed in the blood, and he is filled with the Holy Spirit. Don't you lean over and say anything to my son over there, Gary. I don't want to hear no stories afterwards, but I'm not. I'm closer than some of you, but no, I'm just kidding. I'm one beggar showing another beggar where the bread's at. But watch what he says in 2 Corinthians here, chapter 13, verse 5. Examine yourselves. Examine yourselves. I think we need to do inventory every day. Examine yourselves whether you be in the faith. See, are you in the faith? Are you in the faith or are you faking it? Are you the real thing or are you a hypocrite? Are you honest before God, or are you deceiving yourself? Examine yourself. Even this morning, examine yourself to see whether you be in the faith. Prove your own selves. Test yourselves. Know ye not your own selves? How that Jesus Christ is in you, except you be a reprobate, a hypocrite, a play actor. Here they're examining themselves, which is good. In fact, it's also a fulfillment of prophecy, because in Psalms 26, verse 2, it said that they would examine themselves. It's a fulfillment. We should be examining ourselves. They begin to ask the Lord, is it I? Verse 23 says, and he answered and said, he that dippeth his hand with me in the dish, the same shall betray me. Now, they're having a very intimate meal. Just before the Passover meal, when they'll have all the special bitter herbs and the lamb shank and all of those things, that every one of them had a meaning. And I think scholarship has it right. At this moment, when he says this, Judas Iscariot was dipping his bread alongside of Jesus' bread in the same bowl. And Jesus said, he that dippeth his hand with me in the dish, the same shall betray me. And the Son of Man goeth as it is written of him. This has to happen. It is prophecy that is going to be fulfilled. It is dyed in the wool. It is set in the cast. Jesus must come, suffer, and die, raise again. He must pay for the sins of the world. And I will tell you this, there are things that are set, listen, in stone. There aren't going to change. I don't care what Rick Warren says, that you can change the future. You're not changing the future. It is pre-written. The script will be fulfilled. There are things that are coming that we can read the scriptures and know. We know that things are going to get worse and worse. They're not going to get better and better. We know that there's going to be a seducing spirit in these last days and doctrines of demons. We know that there's going to be a falling away from the biblical faith, and the majority of the church is going to be given to apostasy. We know that from the scriptures. We know that perilous times are afoot. We know that men's hearts are going to fail them for fear of the things that are coming on. We know that the sun and the moon and signs in the heavens, as we've been seeing these solar eclipses and these tornadoes, amazing what happened with Harvey or Henry, whatever that tornado was that hit Texas. Small in size, but greater than any strength of anything ever recorded. Signs that we can point to and say, man, we're living in the last days. And here we read that he said, the Son of Man goeth as it is written of him. You know, so many people are all freaked out about the future. Listen, read your Bible. You know what it's going to be like. Jesus is going to come and take us out of here before it gets a lot worse, but it is going to get really worse during the tribulation. You just need to make sure that you're in Christ. Here's what he says, the Son of Man goeth as it is written of him, but woe unto him or that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. We know from the scripture he must be betrayed, but woe to the man who does this. In fact, he says, it had been better for him that he had never been born. And I think, personally and privately, and I'll just share my thoughts with you, those people that find themselves outside of the saving grace of God on that day of judgment, when they stand before the great white throne and they hear those words, depart from me, you worker of iniquity, I never knew you, and they are cast into outer darkness where there's wailing and gnashing of teeth, where the worm dieth not and the fire is never quenched. I think at that moment when they hear those words, I think people are going to think, I wished I was never born. I wish I was never born. But that nagging thought when they're in that outer darkness, I don't think the greatest torment in hell or in outer darkness is going to be the physical torment. I think it's going to be the fact is it's going to play over and over in their head every opportunity they had to escape, and they mocked it. They mocked it. Just like those men around Noah's ark, mocking him for over 100 years. Some scholars say 120 years. They mocked him until he got in the ark and the door shut and it began to rain. I think the greatest terror is going to understand you're there because you chose to be there. Because God, through the Holy Spirit, had already given you a measure of faith, and he wooed and he called, and you never answered. He stood on the outside of your door and he knocked and you never opened it up. And you're there because of your choices. No man goes to hell, no woman goes to hell because God is angry with them. God's done everything to keep them from that place. You go there because you choose to go there. Now, I believe you can get to hell. A lot of work. You've got to deny what the gospel has presented. You've got to resist the convicting work of the Holy Spirit. You've got to shut down every opportunity that God brings to you to accept. You can get to hell. It's hard work. You can get there. But when you find yourself there, if you do arrive there on that day, it'll be because you chose to be there. And I think that will be haunting. Jesus says, if this man who betrayed Jesus, it was better that he had never been born. Watch verse 25. And Judas, which betrayed him, listen carefully, answered and said, what deception, what hypocrisy. Master? Master? Is it I? He knew it was him. He already had the 30 pieces of silver rattling around in his pocket. He had already made the deal. He had already covenanted with the priests, with Caiaphas and the gang, to betray Jesus. Is it I? Master, is it I? And Jesus said unto him, thou hast said. The idea is you said correct. The most intimidating and scary verse in the Bible for me is found in Matthew chapter 7, verses 23 and 24. It's the one who causes me to do what we just read, to do self-examination. Because there in Matthew chapter 7, Jesus tells us that many will come to him on that day. Many. I don't know how many many is, but it's more than a few. Many will come to him on that day and say, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name? Didn't we work miracles in your name? Didn't we feed the poor in your name? Didn't we do all of these wonderful things in your name? And Jesus will answer and say to them, depart from me, you worker of iniquity. I never knew you. What? But they probably went to church every Sunday. They probably paid their tithe. Put offerings in the box in the back. They probably listened to many, many sermons about self-examination and being born again and serving the Lord. They probably heard the warning of Jesus out of Luke's gospel that said, why do you call me Lord, Lord, and don't do the things that I say? What is the things that Jesus said? You must be born again. That's first and foremost. That's paramount and primary. You must be born again. You can't see or enter the kingdom of heaven. You'll never understand it until you're born again. That was what Jesus was talking about. Not rules and regulations. It's new life in Christ. And many will come and say, Lord, Lord, but didn't we do all of these things? I never knew you. We had no relationship. You were never born again. You see, I think Judas Iscariot, we want to make sure that we add the last name because it defines who we're talking about. I think as he traveled with Jesus for 3 years, heard all the sermons, witnessed all the miracles, nothing changed his heart. With the heart, man believes unto salvation. With the mouth, he confesses. So important. I think as we're looking at these final moments before Jesus goes to the cross, there's great instruction, there's great challenge for us to make sure that we're in the faith, to make sure we've been born again, make sure the Spirit of God is in control, to examine ourselves to see whether we be in the faith. Not just going through motions when there's no emotion. And then he says this in verse 26, and as they were eating, Jesus took bread and he blessed it. Now, most scholars say, and it's indicated in other passages, at this moment, Judas leaves. In fact, in other of the synoptic gospels, we have recorded that Jesus says, go do what you're going to do. Go do it quickly. Get out of here. You're not going to go into the Passover meal with us. And so Jesus, again, has Judas exit, and now he's having this meal with the other 11 disciples. In verse 26, we read, and as they were eating, Jesus took bread, and he blessed it, and he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples and said, take, eat, this is my body. And he took the cup, and when he'd given thanks, it's the third cup of the Passover meal. It's the cup of blessing. And he gave it to them, saying, drink ye all of it. Because we're going to see in a few moments, it represents his blood, this new covenant. And I want to talk to you a few moments about this new covenant. There seems to be this great movement today within Christendom, within the church, to go back to Hebrew roots. Do you understand? We have no Hebrew roots. You need to stop it. It's okay to study those things because as we go through the Old Testament, they have application for the church. But you have no Hebrew roots. You're not Jewish. And if you are saved this morning, you're part of the church. You're not part of Israel. Every Israelite that gets saved this morning becomes part of the church. Our roots go back to Pentecost, and that's as far as they go back. They go back to the crucifixion of Jesus Christ, the Passover lamb, and us being born again from above. We have far greater covenant than the Jews ever had. The Jews' covenant was based on the law and their performance. Ours is based on grace and Christ's performance. Why would you want to go back to the law? And in fact, Paul tells us, writing to the Hebrews, said, listen, you know, if you go back to the law for your justification, there remains no more sacrifice for your sins, but a fearful looking forward to the judgment of God. Because you have crucified underfoot the Son of God, you've counted the grace of his Spirit as an unworthy thing. Are you kidding me? I'm so glad I'm born in the time I was born in. I'm so glad I'm under the covenant of grace. Can I get an amen? How many want to be under the covenant of the law? Don't raise your hand. It's not a trick question. You don't want to be under the law. Thank God we're not under the law. Not that the law is bad. The law is good. The problem is not with the law. The problem is with us. Would you say amen? We can't keep it. And by the way, if you try to keep it, you know what the standard from being justified under the law is perfection. Let me ask you a question. How many this morning are perfect? Just Gary. He's the only one. But I've talked to his wife, and that ain't true. But under grace, this covenant, listen carefully, gang, guys and gals, whosoever will come to me, I will not cast them away. Jesus said, I didn't come for the healthy. Do we qualify? He said, I came for the sick. Do we qualify? I qualify. I came to seek and to save that which is lost. See, I qualify. Unhealthy, sick, lost, that's me. I qualify. I qualify for his grace. That's why Paul writes to the church at Ephesus and says, you are saved by grace through faith, that not of yourselves. It's a gift of God. And by the way, the God that we serve, there is no shadow of turning in him. What he begins, he finishes. You say, I never could understand this doctrine of losing your salvation. See, I think there are pretenders who come and say some words, but never were, like we just read in Matthew 7. But I think to the person who's truly born again, there's no going back. Proverbs said a righteous man can fall 7 times and will always get back up. Because what God begins, he finishes. Because the Bible says, now unto him who is able to present you faultless before the Father of glory. And that also says, unto him who's able to keep you from falling. Amen? I don't keep me from falling. I'm a mess. You know, I actually had a dream when I was waking up this morning that I was falling. And I was crying out to Jesus. And I don't know where this came from, but this big hand caught little bitty me. Boom, just like that. And I woke up thinking, man, that was the coolest dream. What next? Well, I'm falling and I'm screaming. Have you ever fallen in a dream and you're screaming, but the screams don't come out? And I think I had this dream because some of the guys went up to the buttes, the lookout over there by Bassett, and I made an excuse for not to go because I wanted to make sure that if Donna called me that I'd be available to go to the hospital because that place freaks me out. Have you ever been up there and you walk along the grade and you can look right through the bottom of the grade 1,000 feet down? I went up there and my knees got shaky and I remember crawling around the thing and said, are we ready to leave now? I'm afraid of heights. And I was thinking about that, and so last night I dreamed that I was falling. You know, and the hand of God caught me. And by the way, it's a big hand. I was a little bitty thing, big hand. And who is able to pluck you out of that hand? No one. That was the coolest dream. I hope I have it again tomorrow. I hope I have it again tonight. I'd like to have that dream every night until Jesus comes for me. Because I just remember how comforted I was when I landed in that soft hand. That didn't cost you anything extra. Let's get back to the text. You got to be a part of my life there for a moment. Then he says this, for this is my blood of the New Testament, the New Covenant. Please circle that. We're under a different covenant. We study the Old Testament because it sets in context the truth of the New Testament. We study the Old Testament because it is the Word of God. And in every area of the Old Testament, we can prove that Jesus was the Messiah. Much prophecy concerning him. We don't study the Old Testament to become Jewish. Because we're not Jewish. We studied the Old Testament to glean from the Old Testament the things that they went through to learn. But we're part of a new covenant, not an old covenant. We're part of this new covenant. And this new covenant is in the blood of Jesus Christ. This new covenant makes us the church or the bride of Christ, not the wife of God like Israel is. We're the bride of Christ through this new covenant. And Jeremiah prophesied about this new covenant way back when Israel was violating their covenant with God, and he was warning them, if you don't stop all of this idolatry, God's going to judge you, and you're going to be taken from the land that he promised you, and you're going to be in exile. And listen, the Babylonians are coming. Here's what he says in Jeremiah chapter 31, verses 33 and 34. They'll put it up on the screen. Listen carefully. But this shall be the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel. He came to make it with them, and luckily when Israel rejected it, we got it. After those days, saith the Lord, this is the covenant. I will put my law in their inward parts. It's not an outward thing anymore, it's an inward thing. It's not commandments on tablets of stone, it's commandments written upon the heart of flesh. The Holy Spirit living in us, the Spirit of truth. After those days, saith the Lord, I will put my law in their inward parts, and I will write them on their hearts, and they will be their and will be their God, and they shall be my people. He's talking about intimacy and relationship. And then he says this in verse 34, and they shall teach no man, every man his neighbor, and every man his brother, saying, do you know the Lord? What they're talking about is an outward relationship. Have you studied the scriptures? Do you know the Lord? They're not going to say that anymore for this reason. For they shall know me. I'm going to live in them. They're going to know me from the least unto the greatest of them. And listen carefully to this covenant. Saith the Lord, for I will forgive their iniquity and will remember their sins no more. Where have we read that before? Hebrews chapter 10, verse 17. You see, I like Paul. I want to visit him when I get to heaven. Because he makes a statement in Hebrews chapter 1 that takes him 9 chapters to explain. And then in one sentence, one verse, it's the capstone. In chapter 1, he says that Jesus, listen carefully, gang, Jesus by himself, he didn't need your help, he didn't need mine, purged, completely flushed away our sin. And that purging was so complete that when he had finished it, he sat down at the right hand of the Father. No further work necessary. And that's why it says in chapter 2 of Hebrews, if we neglect so great a salvation, this new covenant, in the blood of Jesus, how shall we escape the judgment of God that is to come? Because God offers every man a free pardon in the blood of Jesus through this new covenant. And so Paul tells us that in Hebrews chapter 1. He tells us the penalties if we neglect this greatest salvation, this free gift. And then in chapter 10, he finally gets to the heart of it, and he says in chapter 10, verse 17, and your sins and your iniquities I will remember no more. No doubt quoting from this passage in Jeremiah, we're under a new covenant. In Romans chapter 4, God says, I refuse, because of my son Jesus Christ, to record sin on your account. Can you believe it? You mess up and the devil's before God and he's accusing you because he's still there doing that. He accuses us before God day and night. And I think God does something like this. When he's done, he says, son, what do you think? He said, we ain't writing it down. He said, we know Pastor Mike has some problems. But you know, Satan, he's our problem. And we ain't writing it down. His sins and his iniquities, I will remember no more. This covenant that we're under doesn't cover your sin like in the Old Testament. The Old Testament word for atonement was kophar. We get almost as a direct transliteration into the English word, the word cover. In the Old Testament, your sins were never removed. They were just covered. You brought those sacrifices every time you sinned to cover or appease God, to atone for your sins, to just cover them. But John was able to point to Jesus Christ, the Lamb, the only Lamb of God, and say, behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Our sins aren't covered. They're removed. They're as though they never happened. Can you imagine that? This is the covenant that we're under. I got some time, so just checking. For this is my blood of the new covenant, verse 28, which is shed for the many for the remission. Please circle that word remission. The remission of sins. God doesn't cover your sin. He doesn't wink at your sin. You know what? He doesn't even, if you can understand what I'm about to say, forgive your sin. He removes it as though it never was there. In fact, if you want to write in your Bible somewhere, justification, because in Romans chapter 5, it says, having been past tense, justified by faith, you have peace with God. God will never be angry with you. You have peace with God, you have access to God, and you have a hope in Him. Three things. And the interesting part about that is having been justified. The word justified in the simplest terms for that theological term is this: just as though you never sinned. That's the covenant you have. That's the covenant I have. That's the covenant we have. That's the covenant given to the church, because the church has been washed in the blood of the Lamb. It has been filled with the Spirit. It's been restored back to that original condition as much as possible until we get rid of this old body. And then he says this in verse 29, "But I say unto you, I will not drink henceforth of the fruit of the vine until that day, marriage supper of the Lamb, when I drink it anew with you in my Father's kingdom." I'm not going to sit down and enjoy a meal ever again until I get to enjoy it with you in my Father's kingdom. And I like this, "And when they had sung a hymn," I've got Tracy working on, and I'm going to get Dylan working on, I want to close every worship service, I just felt like the Lord telling me, with a hymn. So we can sing the contemporary stuff, but the last song, I want it to be a hymn. Some of my favorite hymns. I mean, they just, I don't know, listen, if you don't like hymns, you get the contemporary stuff up until the last one. But I like for us to sing a hymn. There's some of them that are just so rich. "Rock of ages, cleft for me. Let me hide myself in thee. Let the water and the blood from thy wounded side, which fled, be for me a double cure. Safe from wrath, and may it be the cure. Before the throne of God, I stand. My name is graven on His hand, written on His heart." No greater truth than that. I dare not stand on the sweetest frame, the frame of religion, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ, the solid rock, I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. When those guys set to pen and paper those hymns, there was something cooking in them that I wish was cooking in the church again today. There was an intimacy and a reality. They understood this covenant and the depth of this covenant and what this covenant had purchased them out of. May we be reminded of that again. "And when they had sung a hymn, they went up to the Mount of Olives." This will be where Jesus will be taken. "And Jesus said unto them, all of you shall be offended because of me this night." You're going to flee. "For it is written," and again he's quoting from Zechariah 13:7, "it is written that if you smite the shepherd, the sheep of the flock shall be scattered." Again, fulfillment of prophecy. "But after I rise again, I will go before thee and meet thee in the Galilee." And no doubt they scurried up after the crucifixion to the Galilee. Now watch this as we conclude our study. Just a couple more verses this morning. In verse 33, it says this: "Peter answered and said unto him, though all men shall be offended because of thee, yet will I never be offended." Have you ever said that to the Lord? "Hey, no matter what everybody else says, I'm never going to fail you, Lord. I'm never going to give up on the faith. I'm never going to walk away from the faith, man. Listen, me and you, Jesus, I knew the rest of these guys were scoundrels." Can you imagine being in that intimate meal and Peter standing up and proclaiming, "The rest of these guys are scoundrels. I get it. I know it. I understand it. But not me, Jesus. Me and you. No matter what the rest of these guys do, I am never going to be offended with you, Jesus. Never." And Jesus says there in verse 34, listen carefully, "Verily I say unto thee that this night," Peter, "this very night, before the cock crows to bring in the morning," the sounding of the morning, you know, trumpet, thou shalt deny me 3 times. Before this night is over, you're going to, in fact, the third time he denied it by cursing. I tell you with a curse word, I never knew the man. I never knew him. And Peter said unto him, though I should die with thee, yet I will not deny thee. Likewise also said the other disciples, we want to get in on this deal. And so they all chimed in. But we know the rest of the story, don't we? We know that 3 times that night he denied he knew the Lord. We know shortly after the 3rd time, historians tell us that the cock crowed. Do you know that many times as Peter traveled preaching the gospel and bringing messages to certain churches, they would mock him along the way? Historians tell us they used to say, cock-a-doodle-doo. And Peter would say, I own it. I own it. I denied him. But I love what Luke's gospel tells us, and they'll put it up on the screen. Watch this in verse 31 and 32 of chapter 22. And the Lord said, because it's not recorded, and Matthew doesn't record this, Luke does. One of the other synoptic gospels records it. And it says this, and the Lord said to Simon, watch what he says, Simon, Simon. Whenever you see 2 words together in the Greek, it has the sense of passion or pathos. Because the Greek language has a voice, and it has 7 tenses, not, you know, past, present, or future like we do, 3 tenses. So when you see, like, verily, verily, I say unto you, or Saul, Saul, we can understand when it's recorded that way, there's kindness, there's passion in this. And so in a very compassionate way, the Lord is saying to Simon, 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 behold, Satan, he's desired to have you. You know what? He's not a respecter of persons either. He wants you. He wants me. We know from the word that the Bible says that Satan's come but to kill, steal, and destroy. He wants us. But watch what he says here. He's desired you. That he may sift you like wheat, that he might grind you up. But I love the next sentence. But I have prayed for thee. Wow. Thank you, Jesus. What did he pray? That your faith fail not. And then he says, and if you make it back, does it say that? Does it say, and if thou art converted or come to your senses? Because he is going to deny the Lord. It doesn't say that, does it? Circle that word, when. When. Because he who began a good work in you is going to complete it. Oh, Peter, you may fail. You may fail miserably. You may even deny that you knew me. You may even deny that you knew me 3 times tonight in my hour of greatest need. But I haven't denied you. You, Peter, may be unfaithful, but I'll never be unfaithful to you. Peter, you might try to let go, but I'm not going to let go of you. Because what I've begun in you, Peter, I'm going to finish. So when thou art converted, strengthen thy brethren. Not only have I not given up on you, but you'll never be a second-rate Christian either. What do you mean? Well, Peter, I'm going to drag you back into the faith. And the ministry that I gave you, the gifts and callings, they're irrevocable. I'm not taking them away. But Lord, I denied you. That's right. Let's take a look at John 21 as we conclude our study, because there's a wonderful conversation that he has. Now, this is not recorded in the Synoptic Gospels, but John records it in his Gospel. You know, the Synoptic Gospels are Matthew, Mark, and Luke. And then you have John, who's kind of, his Gospel stands alone. It's the Gospel of John, but there's greater detail in it than there is, and there's things he adds and things he leaves out. But in John chapter 21, and maybe you find yourself here in this scene, just before verse 15, you know the story that Peter had given up and went back to fishing. Let me just ask you, how many at one time in your life just gave up on serving the Lord and went back to your old life? How many have done that? You gave up and said, you know, I failed. I felt so miserably, there's no way the Lord can forgive me. I'm just going to go back to the drugs. I'm going back to the alcohol. I'm going back to the amoral lifestyle. I'm just going back. Well, Peter did that. And he went back to fishing. And the problem with you going back is you don't ever go alone. He took a bunch of guys with him, the other disciples. And so they're out in the boat and they fish all night long and they catch nothing. Listen, when Jesus is not in your boat, you're a failure. You always will be a failure without Jesus in your boat. But with Jesus in your boat, you'll never be a failure. And so the sun is rising, like this morning. When a sunrise, about 6:30. What a beautiful morning we had with the sun rising. There was a little nip in the air. Maybe it was like that. The sun is rising. They see a figure out on the bank, and the figure cries out to them, "Hey, you caught any fish?" Now, if it had been Mike and John, they would have said, "You shot us all, the one that got away." Because those guys are always fishing. Or Brian. He's always telling me about his fishing stories. You know, he's a commercial fisherman. "Hey, did you guys catch anything?" "No, didn't catch anything. Fished all night, caught nothing." And the voice says, "Cast your net on the other side." Can you imagine Peter saying, "Is that dude crazy? What's the difference between this side of this little bitty boat and that side of this little bitty boat?" But there's something stirring in his heart, because the first time he met Jesus, he came in and had caught nothing. And Jesus said, "Let's go out again." He said, "Nah, we've been fishing all day. There's nothing out there today." Jesus said, "Trust me." You remember when he first met Peter. And he said, "Cast your net here." And they got a great harvest. Something is familiar. And so they cast their net, and they catch such a harvest that the net is ripping. They can't get it into the boat. Jesus is there on the bank. Now he's in their life again. He commands them. They're obedient, and now the harvest comes. Peter says to John, "That's the Lord." Peter girds himself and casts himself into the sea. The indication in the scripture is the boat arrives the same time Peter does. He's still impetuous. And then this conversation after they get done, because Jesus has some fish on the fire, after, no doubt, Eastern Brookies, that's my favorite, had some fish on the fire, and after dinner, Jesus says unto Simon Peter, "Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me more than these?" Now, was he talking about the fish or the other disciples? Seriously, that's been a controversy for years among scholarship. Because he left the Lord to go back to fishing. Or was he talking about his proclamation before his denial that he loved the Lord more than the rest of the disciples? I think both. I think Jesus is saying, do you really love me more than the rest of the disciples? And do you love me more than the things of this world? "Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me more than these?" He saith unto him, "Yea, Lord." And I don't think it was a, "Yea, Lord." I think it was, "You know, Lord. Thou knowest I love thee." He saith unto them, "To feed my sheep." The word there that Peter uses is not agape. It's phalo. "Lord, you know I'm your friend." What the Lord asked him is, "Peter, do you agapeo me? Do you love me with a divine love?" And Peter answers, "Yes, Lord, we're friends." So Jesus asks the question the second time. He saith unto him the second time, "Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? Do you agapeo me?" He said to him, "Yea, Lord, thou knowest that we're friends. I phalo you." He saith unto him, "Then feed my sheep." And the third time, he saith unto him, "Simon, son of Jonas, do you agapeo me? Do you lovest thou me?" I think at this moment, Peter is so shame-based for his failure. But at this moment, the pain of his failure does not drive him. What he's driven by is God's forgiveness. Peter was grieved because he asked him the third time, "Lovest thou me?" And he said, "Lord, thou knowest all things. You know that I failed you. I did the very thing I said I wouldn't do. And I failed you. I denied you. In your hour of greatest need, I even cursed and denied you. Why are we having this conversation? No doubt is what Peter's thinking. But he forgot what Jesus said before his failure. When you come to your senses, when you are converted, I want you to continue in the ministry that I've given you. Lovest thou me? And he said unto him, Lord, thou knowest all things. Thou knowest that I agape you. Lord, I love you with all of my heart. Then Jesus said, feed my sheep. I didn't give up on you, Peter. Peter, I was the guy that told you were going to mess up before you messed up. Remember when you were jumping up and waxing bad and up in everybody else's grill saying, hey, you bunch of idiots, whether you guys do this, I'm still going to serve Jesus to the death. Me and you, Jesus, to the death. You remember that, Peter? Yeah, I remember that. Didn't work out so well for you, did it, Peter? No, it didn't. You know what your problem is, Peter? Pride. One of the other events that Matthew doesn't record is the washing of the feet of the disciples during that meal. And when he came to Peter, he said, you're not going to wash my feet. What did that reveal in Peter? Pride. And Jesus said, if I don't wash your feet, you're not of me. And Peter said, not just my feet, but all of me. He said, you don't need all of you to be washed. That's already been taken care of. But you need to get rid of the pride. So let me wash your feet. What is Jesus telling us today? Very simple. Here's the application for the things we've read. What would you betray your master for? I hope nothing. I hope your salvation through grace is more important than anything in this life. And it's non-negotiable with the devil. I pray that the greatest commandment that Jesus talked about is resident in your heart, that you should love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength. This is the first and great commandment, to the degree and to the extent that nothing else is more important than that relationship. Nothing. Secondly, I hope that you understand that we're under a new covenant. And it is a covenant of grace purchased by Christ on the cross and the shedding of his blood. And this covenant that we're in is not for the covering of your sin, but for the absolute removal of your sin. So that when God sees you, he sees no stain on you because the blood of Jesus Christ has washed it. For all time and for all eternity, you have been justified by faith. That you understand that. And that you understand. And it's good that it is in your heart, like it was in the heart of Peter, that you make those proclamations. Lord, I'm going to serve you all the days of my life. And how many have said this when you mess up, you know, when you've sinned miserably? And you're in that process of because the Holy Spirit's dealing with you and you're confessing it and you're repenting of it. And how many have made that mistake of saying, I'll never do that again? How many have said that? I'll never do that again, Lord. Just forget, I'll never do that again. How many have said that? Liar. I mean, the heart is in the right place because I've said it. Lord, I'll never do that again. Man, that was crazy in San Francisco traffic. I'll never do that again. A year and a half later, we're down to the airport to pick up Doug and Des. Why? You said you would never do that again. Oh, Lord, I'm so sorry. That's okay. I got it. What you ought to have said is, your heart's not in that. You want to serve me. You see, God searches the heart. What's in your heart? That's what he said to Solomon, David's, and we'll end with this. We will end with this. David's son. He said to Solomon, it was good that was in your father David's heart to build a house for me. Even though he couldn't perform it. What's in your heart? Examine yourself as we saw this morning and see whether you be in the faith. Is it in your heart to serve the Lord your God with all of your heart? Even in your failures, because you will fail. But is it in your heart? After you've failed, when Jesus comes to you, because he'll never give up on you. It's always a win and not an if. And he says to you, do you love me? More than these, more than your sin, more than the fish, more than the other people. You should be able to look him in the eye and say, Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you with all of my heart, but I got this stinking flesh. And this flesh betrays me. I've got an El Desperado living in me, and sometimes he gets loose. But you know that in my heart of hearts, there's nothing I want more than to be perfect before you. And God will look at you and say, then that's enough. That's enough. Because man looks on the outward appearance. That's what religion does. God searches the heart. And he knows what's in your heart. And he knows when you feel how it grieves you. How many have said, oh, I wish I wasn't this way? How many have said that? Lord, I wish I wasn't this way. You know what God says? You're not. Because I see things that are not as though they already were. You're not. You're not that way anymore. I don't see it. I won't write it down. You're justified. What a wonderful covenant. Amen. I'm glad I'm not in the Old Testament. I like studying that stuff, but I'm glad I don't live there. Amen. Are you kidding me? I would be broke because I wouldn't have any sheep. They'd all be down there at the tabernacle cooking on the altar. And it would be like I'd have to take a herd with me just in case I get in traffic on the way. So there's a mule, you know, pile up. And now I'm stuck in mule traffic. And now I better have enough sheep to take care of the sin that happens when I'm in mule traffic. No. I thank God every day for Jesus Christ in this covenant of grace. Amen? Well, let's stand. Get the worship single guy. Hey, I'm telling you, I thought he did a good job, just him and Mike. No women's voices or nothing. Man, it's a brave man to stand up here by himself. And that was good. But Dylan asked if he could sing a different song than our blessing song. I don't know what he has for us, but since he's by himself and probably doesn't have Tracy to aid him with the other song, maybe he's not as comfortable with that. But whatever he has, I think it's from the Lord. Now, let me ask you this. I want to challenge you this morning. How many know without a shadow of a doubt that Jesus is yours and you're his? There's an old hymn that says that. I am his and he is mine. You know that. How many know this morning that the blood of Jesus Christ has not just covered your sin but removed it? How many know this morning you are saved by grace and what God began in you, he's going to finish? How many rejoice in that? Amen. That's where we need to camp out. Hey, gang. So let's pray and then we'll sing this song. Father, I pray as we conclude our service this morning. You know, as Jesus is coming to the final moments of his life, and there's great insight and instruction that's going on here, that we would be those who would not sell our birthright for a measly bowl of red beans like Esau did. That we would, Lord, be those who examine ourselves to see whether we be in the faith. We wouldn't be those that are deceived. And Lord, we'd be those who trust this new covenant of grace. And Lord, we don't trust our flesh. We don't trust our works. We trust you and what you have done. And Lord, I pray that every person has that dream that I had last night. I pray that they feel the terror of falling and the sheer panic that was in that dream of mine. But Lord, they feel the sheer joy of that hand catching them. And what a sense of hope. I pray that, Lord, because that's what you've done for us. We were falling and you have caught us. And we thank you for that. We thank you, Father, for that in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's sing this song.
Worthy is the Lamb.
was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you. Flashes of lightning, rolls of thunder. Blessing and honor, strength and glory and power be to you, the only wise King. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you.
As Dylan just continues to play this, let's have every head bowed. I just feel like the Holy Spirit is asking me to do something, and then we'll close our service. Every head bowed, every eye closed. If you're here this morning and you have not been born again, if you have not invited Jesus Christ to come into your heart and make you a new creature in Him, you might be religious, you may do religious things, but you can't say that you know Him. If that's you this morning and you want this salvation, you want that God would completely cleanse you of all sin, that He'd write your name in the book of life, and so that when He comes back, He will say to you, I know you, you're mine, and I'm yours. If you want that this morning, then just raise your hand. We're not going to take long, but if that's you this morning, thank you. Anyone else? Thank you. Anyone else? So important that you leave this life knowing Him and Him knowing you. Is there anyone else? Because we don't want you to stand, and neither does Jesus. He came to seek and to save that which is lost. He doesn't want you to stand before His Father one day and hear those words, depart from me, you worker of iniquity, I never knew you. He doesn't want you to be cast into the lake of fire that was prepared for the devil and his angels. He doesn't want you to go there. Done everything to keep you from going there. But he is a gentleman, and he stands at your heart's door and he knocks. You have to open the door. And is there anyone else this morning that wants to do that? Two people raise their hands. Anyone else? Then let's pray. Father, we pray for these two. And Lord, together, we're just going to say these words with them out loud. Lord Jesus, forgive me. I acknowledge that I'm a sinner and I need a Savior. I acknowledge that I can't fix my problems, that I need you, Father. I acknowledge that your word is true and I've been a liar. And I now confess you, Lord Jesus, as my Savior and my Master. Please come into my heart. Forgive me of my sins. Be my Lord. Be my Savior. And I pray this in the name that is above every name. I pray this in the name that one day every knee is going to bow and every tongue is going to confess that He is the Lord. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. So all of you just got saved again. God bless you. Let's pray one more time. Father, for these that raise their hands, Lord, you know who they are. Nobody else needs to this morning. I just felt that it needed to be private. But may they bear the fruits of repentance. And Lord, may you fill them with the joy of their salvation. And now, Lord, we just pray that, Lord, your grace and your love would be upon us, that your Holy Spirit would be so in us that it would keep us blameless, Lord, till you come again. We're so looking forward to that moment. And so, Lord, we thank you for this day. Again, we pray for so many of the ladies of our church that are over there just suffering for you, Lord. In the beach community of Bodega Bay. Lord, we pray for them so that they just could endure eating that clam chowder at Spud Point. And Lord, in all jest, we just pray that you would bless our wives and our sisters in the faith, Lord, as they just get this time to get away. Bring them back safely to us. Continue to pray for Scott and for Susan, Lord, for healing. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. And all God's kids would say, amen. Amen.